thick smog has forced class suspensions in parts of Metro Manila. Several cities in the capital region have already suspended classes. City officials said the smog came from Taal volcano, but state seismologists say the smog is not related to Taal because it is not headed for Metro Manila. The volcano is currently under alert level 1, but it has been emitting around 3,000 tons of volcanic sulfur dioxide daily since the first week of September. Residents in affected areas are encouraged to limit outdoor activities and wear face masks when they are outside. Well, parts of Batangas are affected by the smog from Taal volcano. Let's get an update now from our very own Jeff Caparaz. He joins us from Tanawan in Batangas. Jeff, go ahead.
Yes, Carmina, actually, we've reached the Talisay town in Batangas. And on the way here, Carmina, we've observed some residents are not wearing masks, while some are wearing it. The MDRMO are on alert for possible evacuation. And we've learned that barangay officials are going around to warn the residents to stay indoors and to wear masks. A few minutes back, Carmina, as you've said, we've stopped at Baywalk in Barangay Ambulong, Tanawan, and the usual view of the Taal volcano is covered by the haze caused by Taal's volcanic smog or VOD. We've also seen children and residents who seem not to mind the smog, and they said they are used to it. Joel Molato, a resident of the barangay, said it is around 6 this morning when they saw the volcano emit smog. Joel adds today he is on alert for possible scenarios, as well as some personnel of DPWH around the Baywalk who is also on standby for possible evacuation. The local government of Tanawan has suspended the classes in all levels in public and private schools and reminded residents to stay indoors and wear masks if going outside. Carmina, Randy De La Paz of the Office of the Civil Defense, Calabarzon, informed us via text message that right now there are no evacuation yet in the region.
A delegation from the Commission on Human Rights has arrived in Surigao del Norte to investigate allegations of rape and child marriages against a local religious group. Nico Bawanao joins us now with details. Nico, what more can you tell us?
Hi, Carmina. We're here inside the community of the Socorro Bayanihan Services Incorporated, where they were able to receive different guests for today. A delegation from the local media, the national media, and a delegation from the Commission on Human Rights, which came from Manila, and they just arrived a few minutes ago. They are currently at the community center of the group, where they are being treated to a cultural show, which was produced and prepared by the group. But earlier today, when we got here, we were able to interview the president of the group, Jay Renz, or more popularly known as Senor Aguila. And basically, he was denying all the allegations of rape, forced labor, forced marriages of the minors here, the Shabu Laboratory, of members who are forced to give half of their earnings to the organization. He also denied the existence, allegedly, of a private army and arms in their community. Basically, it's a blanket denial of all the allegations being thrown at them, especially the testimonies that were given by the six children who were rescued or after they escaped from this community and went to the town proper, to the municipal hall, and gave their statements about these allegations. According to their president, Mr. Jay Renz Hilario, he was saying that all these allegations are born out of politicking in this province. He claims that the current mayor now, and the other leaders of this province, had interests in controlling this group because they have a population of more than 3,000 people, and it's a voting block for them. And they did not support certain leaders in their province, and they feel that they are at the receiving end now of those leaders that they did not support during the elections. So they're claiming that all these allegations that are coming up are made up and fabricated to force them to bend or to follow the influence of these leaders. And they're opening their community now to different sectors, and they're even inviting Senator Risa Hontiveros and other national leaders and other investigating bodies to come here and see for themselves what the community is about, and for them to be able to present their side in saying that none of these allegations are true. Carmina?
All right, just a quick question for you, and Nico. Of course, the concern really was when the story broke out, was going out to the children. Were you able to observe the children in the community? And did something strike you as sort of something that's out of the ordinary when you look at them?
It really depends on how you look at it, Carmina. If you invite certain people, outsiders in your community, of course you'll be not really forced, but you would want to present all the good things about your community. So we can't really say which is true or not true, or what we feel about what we're hearing and seeing from what the people are saying. Mm-hmm. I was able to interview some of the parents, and of course they were absolutely denying all the testimonies of these children. And when I asked them why would their kids, their own kids, would claim these things about how they're living and suffered in this community, and they said they feel like their children were coached, their children were forced to fabricate these stories. Mm. So the reputation of their organization would be destroyed. So in fact, these parents want their kids back, especially the six kids who are still under the custody of the DSWD. They've filed a motion for a writ of habeas corpus for the court to force the DSWD to present these children and for these children to be brought back to the community or to their parents. Mm. But when we spoke to the DSWD and we saw the children yesterday under their care, they said that they didn't want to come back here because they don't want to relive and experience the same trauma that they underwent when they were here, and that is why they escaped. So to answer your question, I did see children here, I did see parents, and there was this whole cultural presentation. There was singing and dancing when we were here. But as what some of the former members told me, it's difficult to say or to speak out on what they truly feel about what they feel that's going here, because there's always that fear of retaliation, the fear of their relatives being hurt, the fear of being punished for speaking out. But if you talk to some of the residents here, which I did, they say that they're not being threatened, there's no threats, there's no punishments, nothing of that sort. Mm-hmm. So the whole time I've been here since this morning, it's been they've been painting a pretty picture of not really a utopia, but of a simple community of trying to help each other and promote good values and culture, basically. Carmina.
All right. Thanks a lot. Nico Bawa, of course, has been following this story very closely. So stay tuned to all of our newscasts here on ANC for his series of reports on this. Thanks a lot, Nico, for joining us this noon. Really appreciate it. The Office for Transportation Security admits the problem of misconduct among airport personnel runs deep. OTS Administrator Undersecretary Mao Aplaska says since 2022, around 70 of their personnel have been charged for various offenses. The agency also looking at a possible syndicate victimizing passengers at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. Aplaska, meanwhile, assures the public reforms are underway to rid NAIA of erring personnel.
Initially, we thought these cases are just isolated cases, but based on the number of cases that has happened already, I think the problem is deeper than what we thought. That's a simple issue of misconduct. We are now looking at maybe we will now approach by way of culture change in our organization. So it is a bit difficult, but we will not stop. The Department of Transportation under the leadership of Secretary Bautista will not sleep or rest until we have arrested or charged the last shenanigans in the airport.
As for the alleged theft involving a screening officer who swallowed dollar bills, Aplasca says they have gathered enough evidence to charge her and her accomplices.
Even up to today, the suspect continues to deny that she got any money. But based on the evidence gathered by investigators, I think we have enough evidence to charge her. There are now four screening officers who are now being investigated and possibly has something to do with the incident. Based on our records, this is the first incident that somebody swallowed a bill. We have four previous incidents of extortion and theft at the checkpoint.
The U.S. government suing former Philippine Elections Chief Andy Bautista for money laundering and conspiracy. This after his estranged wife, Patricia Paz Bautista, flagged his alleged ill-gotten wealth worth 1 billion pesos. Bautista allegedly received bribe money from an unnamed poll technology company in exchange for securing nearly $200 million in election contracts related to the 2016 polls. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security reportedly filed a case against Bautista at a court in Florida on September 19. As for Bautista, he insists he did not ask for nor receive any money from Smartmatic or any other entity. He also vouched for the integrity of the 2016 polls, adding the Supreme Court had unanimously dismissed an election protest in connection with a vice presidential contest. Smartmatic, meanwhile, declined to comment on the matter.